So here's the first one. Let's hear the gun and watch the reaction. Remember that it's Hinkson in lane one. On the far side of your picture, the inside lane. Well, that was absolutely no doubt about that, and he had the smile on his face which acknowledged that this was down to him.
Yeah, very much so. I think, I mean, all sprinters, particularly in the decathlon, when you're looking for points, are trying to get away as quickly as they can, and he would forgive himself that first error of in his anxiety to get away, he made a full start. Absolutely clear cut, no argument.
So you'd allow him that one. He's trying to get as close to the gun as possible, obviously. But let's see the build up now to the second start. And once again, Dave, very convincingly, Hinkson.
Yep, no argument whatsoever about that. And in the sprint event, in the 100-metre sprint event, you're only allowed two full starts. And he's fortunate in the decathlon, they do allow three. So having made this mistake twice, he didn't stand much chance of getting away with it on the third time. And the fellow next to him, Tarnowenski, he'd already made one full start in between the two that Hinkson made. So really, you know, everybody was aware that come the third one, particularly Hinkson with having two full starts against him, come the third one, he had to wait.
Right. Well, lane one setting off lane two to a certain extent. We've noticed in the first two that Hinkson is down in his blocks very early on. Let's see how he sorts himself out as he approaches the third start. And if he misses this one, he's disqualified.
I mean, it doesn't look like a full start, but as I said, they have got the electric timing and the way the machine is set up that is determined not by the eye of the starter, but by the system that's used. And at this point, Hinkson hadn't got a clue, or at least he wasn't showing, that he thought it was him that had made the full start. I think he thought it was Freema, the East German, in lane four in blue vest.
But as you look at that, there's at least three athletes rising together, and Hinkson is just one of them for the naked eye. Anyway,
as again, Tarnowenski, the Soviet Union athlete, looked as if he'd got at least the same start as Hinkson.
And this is the point that Hinkson is going to realise the awful truth.
Now the third, like the one in the middle, which is the killer one, that goes on, and at this point, Hinkson's told.
Wasn't a full start, he's saying. He's looking across at his coach.
Yes.
almost sense a kind of panic setting in now for Hinkson. It's not my false start, it's not my false start, he keeps saying, and you have to have a lot of sympathy with him.
You do. What he's calling for now is the reaction time, which is tabulated on that bit of paper that we see soon, and that's reaction time to the gun, the time it took between the gun going and him putting pressure against the block to drive away. And that's the thing that determines whether or not you've done a false start. And as I said before, it isn't the starter's decision. Normally we associate the starter makes that decision. But in this instance, at major championships, be it Ben Johnson or Jürgen Hinkson, it's all electronically, it works electronically. And that's what he's actually looking for, that tape that determines the time it took for him to react. And any appeal will be based on that tape. And really, I would have thought the only chance that Hinkson stands is that if in fact the mechanism was faulty, because presumably at this point they would look at the tape and see that in fact it was a false start.
But they would also see surely that it was mighty close between Hinkson and a lot of the other runners. Well, is there any room for discretion in something like this, bearing in mind that it's a decathlon after all?
Yeah, as far as I know, there is no room for manoeuvre. The discretion or the manoeuvre is given in allowing three full starts as opposed to two. And there is a dividing line, whatever that is. If he's inside that, then they have no choice. In fact, I think if it was the old system of the starter's discretion, then he would have got away with it.
Oh, sure.
I think there's no doubt that a starter would not have picked that up. But once the little buzzer goes, which it would have done, the starter would have no choice but to sound the gun. And it's left in the hands of the computer then, and it's an argument between Hinkson and the computer at the moment. But it is a tragedy for him. I mean, it's bad enough in the pole vault. You've got the certain discipline, certain events where it's where you panic a little bit. The pole vault particularly, quite a number of people have come unstuck and had three failures there. But I've never known of anybody be eliminated this way in a decathlon. And certainly not a fella of Hinkson's ability and experience.
The other events are perhaps slightly different. I mean, all he really had to do on the third start is just to wait. Cost himself a couple of tenths of a second, maybe, but he would stay in the competition.
Oh, yeah, I think when he reflects on it, and obviously at the moment he's extremely annoyed and frustrated, and that will last for a long time. But safety has got to come first, and in the final analysis on that third start, the sensible thing, obviously, is to wait that bit longer and get away safely. So, okay, like it costs you a tenth of a second.
Here's another look at that final one. See who rises
you just
together.
Look at the shoulders and the head coming up and see whether we can determine whether it's Hinkson first.
Yeah.
He began. Yeah, lane three is Valenta, the Czech. And again, it's really difficult to tell that. I'm absolutely certain that the starter would not have called that a full start. It isn't as clear-cut as many, many starts you see.
No.
But, as I said before, the advantage or disadvantage, whichever way you look at it, of the electronic system now, is that machines have taken over.
It does seem a shame that computers have taken over, machines have taken over. Is there such a thing still as the spirit of the competition? And a judge who can sit down and say, well, that thing was so close that we can't separate it, and we will give Hinkson the benefit of the doubt.
I think really that the fact that it is electronic actually is an advantage. I mean, certainly in terms of Ben Johnson in the past, it's proven that his start is okay. It's just that he happens to get away very, very quickly.
Hinkson now exiting the stadium. He's still got an appeal going on, hasn't he?
Yeah, the appeal system, as Ron Pickering said, is that'll be interesting to see what happens now, because if it is upheld and he does get the opportunity of registering a performance, then presumably they're going to have to let him run 100 on his own. But at the moment, walking down the tunnel, that doesn't look like a bloke that's going to be running and taking part in the decathlon anymore.
And presumably once the long jump gets going, then there's no time for him to run 100 metres.
That's right, yes. And normally the appeals procedure takes time, which if it's a disqualification about Tom McKean, they can afford that time, because it's not until the next day that they've got another heat. Mm. But in this instance, as you said, moving on to the long jump and then getting beyond that, that procedure has got to be speeded up and the decision's got to be made very, very quickly.
Much has been made of the camaraderie of the decathlon. Did it surprise you that no other athletes came forward and said, hey, it's a bit unfair on him?
Yeah, I mean, it Payson was sort of walking along looking for support, and the rest sort of threw their arms up in the air and looked the other way. I mean, it's difficult to say whether they should or shouldn't support him. Obviously, they would be put off by the delay, but they would be aware that the decision wasn't theirs, wasn't necessarily the starter's, but was that of the machine. And rightly or wrongly, the machine determines nowadays whether you make a false start or not.
And knowing Daly's attitude, he won't get any satisfaction out of a rival like that being eliminated in that way.
Not at all. There is a camaraderie between them, and there's a great rivalry, but at the same time, if Daly wins, he wants to win against the best opposition that can be there, and fair and square. I think if somebody fails in the pole vault, that's slightly different, because that's part of the skill of the event. But to be put out that way. But interestingly enough, Hinks is still warming up. He's doing a few strides, which is sensible, because if he is put back in, he's going to have to run 100 metres very quickly. Not necessarily, I don't mean in time, but I mean they won't give him a great amount of time to do it, because he's then got to go on to the long jump.
I suppose he might be making a few points as well, being out there on the track warming up as well.
Yeah, well, I mean, what else do you do? I mean, I guess really he's better off out there doing a few strides than sitting down in the tunnel panicking. It can't be the most pleasant of occasions for him, and not the way, even if it was upheld, not the way to prepare for all the other events.
Well, it's confirmed from the stadium, which we ought to underline, he's not been obviously disqualified from the whole of the decathlon, but he's just been disqualified from the sprint. But obviously it gives him no chance in the rest of the whole event, is it?
That's right. Once you miss out on one event, you're immediately 1,000 points or 900 points behind the rest of the opposition, and you've got no chance. But yes, you are allowed, he's certainly allowed to continue, and he's allowed to complete the decathlon if he wants, but that won't be on his mind at the moment. On his mind will be trying to register 100 metres.
Sure. Well, we'll be back for the long jump, which is the next element of the decathlon. And we now hear that the appeal has been turned down. Hinkson is out of the competition. There's Daly preparing for the next event, the long jump. But Hinkson out of the competition after those three false starts, and I understand that he's about to talk to an American reporter at trackside.